In addition to CPU and memory, computers also have input-output devices. For example, keyboard, mouse, monitor, disk, etc. These are collectively referred to as I/O devices. They are shorthand for input and output respectively. I/O devices are mainly divided into block devices and character devices. For example, a disk is a block device, and its transmission uses a continuous block as a basic transmission unit. Each block has an independent disk address for easy reading and writing. There is nothing to do with each other, that is, read from different locations on the disk and support random read and write. For example, the keyboard produces individual characters. They form a character stream in order and cannot be read or written randomly. Let's take the disk as an example. I/O devices are generally composed of mechanical parts and electronic parts. The electronic components are called device controller or adapters. It is usually on the computer motherboard. The device controller directly controls the I/O device. After issuing the command, the disk sends a binary bit stream to the controller with a checkcode at the end. Then there is a buffer area in the device controller. After receiving this bit stream to form a block, it is checked with the received checkcode. After it is correct, it tries to send it to the memory. However, the device controller cannot transfer to the memory by itself, and the command of the CPU is required at this time. So, how does the CPU communicate with the device controller? The device controller usually has some registers. The CPU can send and receive data, turn on or turn off, and understand the status of the device by reading and writing these registers. So in order to read and write, each device register needs a number. One method is to directly assign a dedicated I/O port number. The port number of all device registers form a unique I/O port space. The operating system needs to use special instructions. For example, to transfer the contents of the controller register port number 4 to the CPU register R0, and this 4 in the move instruction refer to the address of the memory. Then there is also out, which transfers the value in the register to port number 4. In this way, although two address spaces are clearly divided, but special instructions are also required. Another way is to use the port as a high address part of the memory. In this way, when the address accessed by MOV is in this special address range, it is actually communicating with the device controller, and otherwise it is no more memory access. This is called memory mapped I/O. Of course, this need to be determined which range the address is in each time. That is a disadvantage. Therefore, it is also possible to mix above two, the high address store buffer in the memory device controller, and the remaining control registers have a special I/O address space. Next, if the device controller completes a block of data, it needs the command of the CPU to transport it to the memory and point the destination address to the next location. However, every time a block is transferred, the CPU must be interrupted to process it, which is too inefficient. Therefore, we need an intermediary called Direct Memory Access, or DMA for short. There are several registers in the DMA which are used to store, for example, the destination memory address, byte count, and some controller registers. The CPU will preset the length of all read and write content, as well as the destination address. Then, the CPU can do other things. The DMA first sends a read request to the device controller. After device controller has received it, DMA follows the memory address to transfer data to the memory. Next, the byte count is decremented by one unit, and the memory address is incremented by one unit. If the byte count is still greater than zero, then continue to transmit data. When the byte count reaches zero, the DMA sends a signal to the CPU to end the reading. Okay, that's all for today's video. See you in the next issue.